To start just a couple of minutes early today, we have more than our fair share of fun today. All right, always looking for my good side, but we haven't found it yet. All right, on the Pledge of Allegiance, let's see, who should we do that? President-elect, would you like to lead us in our Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All righty. We have a song heading our way. Gentlemen.
Yeah, we need more singers, Mark.
We have words, they say.
We have words.
Yippee. We need more singers up here. Anybody want to sing with us? Come on up.
All right.
Well, Jeff is going to give us a talk about the fire service. And we're so glad he's doing that. But we thought we'd celebrate that by singing with you Elvis's Burnin' Love.
Got to shake the hips.
No, we're not going to do that.
Okay. One, two, three, four. Lord Almighty, I feel my temperature's rising. Higher and higher is burning through my soul. Girl, 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 you're going to set me on fire. My brain is flaming and I don't know which way to go.
Yeah.
Your kiss is lifting higher, like the sweet song of a choir. Light my morning sky with the bird you love. Ooh, 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 feel my temperature rising. Tell me, flames, I must be 109. Burning, 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 but nothing can cool me. I get my turn in smoke, and I feel fine. Your kisses lift me higher, like the sweet song of the choir. You light my morning sky in burning love.
Here we go.
I'm just a hunk of burning love. I'm just a hunk of burning love. I'm just a hunk of burning love. Burning love.
Woo! All right, and the fan goes wild. That was amazing. All right. Our thought for the day. Mr. Pat.
So I have a brief but profound message from Paul Harris today. Paul Harris, as you all know, was the founder of Rotary International. Success is not measured by wealth, but by the positive impact you have on others. Paul Harris.
Well, if that is how we're getting graded, the folks in this room are doing pretty well. So congratulations to all of you. Okay, our meeting front line. We've got Linda doing our Spur report and Don doing the publishing. Don also doing the photographer and Dennis doing the audio visual. Is there a rhythm to the tilt?
Well, yeah, I was being clumsy. I tipped over and Don was kind enough to hold me up.
Ah,
but you notice on the right, Sonia and Jeff are just laughing their ass off.
I'll take your word for it, but Sonia and Jeff at the far right. All right, and on our next page, we have our sergeants and our Trex and Bob. Well, one half of Trex and Bob. And then we've got our web marauder. Ah, that's a good one. Another M word, Kathy Coyle. Public outreach is Kelly Bowers, and our videographer is Niall Runge. All right, right there, we've got the video going. Okay, introduction of visiting Rotarians and guests. Out in Zoom land, do we have either? Neither? Neither. All right. In the room, do we have any visiting Rotarians? Turning on your microphone very carefully. Still turning on the microphone carefully. And giving it a quick moment to warm up. Now,
okay.
There we go.
It's my pleasure to introduce John Kimber with the Niles Rotary Club, and his classification is real estate.
Now, remember what we're all supposed to do?
Hello, John.
Very good. You are trainable. Okay. Are there any other visiting Rotarians? It's a lot of people moseying in the room, but nobody else is standing up. So we're going to move on to visitors or guests of Rotarians. Do we have anyone who is a visitor or a guest? Yes, we do.
Yes. President Mark, let me introduce Gabriel Wright. We had a good chat here. Gabriel met Sheila, and Sheila sent him to here to be a potential Rotarian. Gabriel is a financial advisor, and hopefully you'll join.
Very good. Yay. All right. Are there any other visitors or guests here who are not our students of the month or their relatives? Okay. All right. We'll move on from there. And so, okay, everybody on their best behavior because we have a potential Rotarian in the room. All right. Okay. Let's start with students of the month. Bill, are you going to lead us off here? Very good.
I'm very pleased to, again, present our students of the month. And as I was sitting there listening to us sing and thinking of high school seniors, all of these are seniors coming to us, wondering how different their world is from the world we all grew up in. And I sat there realizing, you know, my 8-year-old granddaughter has no idea who Elvis Presley was. And so, we ought to know that as we start singing our songs and think they are universal. Things pass away. Oh, well. But we do have Student of the Month, and that does not pass away. We have it with us today. And we have three Students of the Month. We'll be presenting from Livermore High School. They are Justin Blanton, Angelina Bhatia, and Kerrigan Coates. Please welcome the principal of Livermore High School, Roxana Mustafa, who will present these students to us.
Now, Bill, how long have you known me? It's Muhammad, man. All right, you guys. So I'm going to go ahead and call. Thank you for letting me do this again. I enjoy this as one of the best parts of my job. I think I tell you guys that every time I get to do this. But I do appreciate the opportunity to just, you know, brag about some of our kids at Livermore High. So I want to bring up Justin Blanton. It's so quiet in here. You guys are usually not this quiet. Like, I don't understand. You are attentive. I appreciate it. You okay? Turn and face. All right. All right. Ready? Ready to hear the good stuff? All right. Justin Blanton is an exceptional student at Livermore High School, and his achievements both inside and outside of the classroom truly speak for themselves. Justin holds an impressive GPA of 3.95 while excelling in a rigorous course load that includes AP Computer Psych, his passion, AP Calculus, AP Chem, and Honors Civil Engineering and Architecture.
What?
He also has taken Robotics, Photography, and the CTE IT Essentials courses, showcasing his diverse interests and commitment to learning. His academic excellence has consistently earned him a place on the principal's honor roll, yes it has, and the prestigious Block L Award. So one of Justin's most remarkable accomplishments has been his involvement with our Gravitech X robotics team, which you guys have helped fund in the past, so thank you for that. As the team driver during the 2024 season, Justin helped lead the team to its best ever record, ranking 12th in the state and placing in the top 4% of over 3,400 teams worldwide. Did you guys catch that? That was worldwide, let me just say. All right. His leadership didn't stop at the driver's seat. Justin developed an autonomous program for the robot, enabling it to score maximum points during the autonomous period of the competition. He also co-led or is the co-lead of the programming team, mentoring and guiding his peers as they transition to a more advanced robot base. His technical expertise has been an asset to not only his team, but other teams as well, as he has offered assistance with coding and electrical challenges at competitions and community events. Justin demonstrates strong leadership in his roles as club treasurer and former club secretary. His dedication to the team is matched by his desire to give back to the community. He has volunteered over 100 hours tutoring in subjects like biology, chemistry, engineering, physics, and computer science. Justin also contributed to outreach efforts, helping future students discover the world of robotics at events like the Science of Stockman's Park and the Tri-Valley Innovation Fair. As Justin enters his senior year, which he is already in, his goals are clear: to achieve top scores on his AP exams, yay, goal, and help his team qualify for the World Championships in Texas. I can't wait. His aspirations for the future are just as exciting, with plans to pursue a career in programming or computer science and a dream to work at the Lawrence Livermore Lab right here in our community. Did you guys hear that? No. All right. What stands out most about Justin isn't just his remarkable list of accomplishments, but his humility, his leadership, and willingness to help others. He exemplifies the spirit of innovation, perseverance, and community engagement that we strive to instill in all of our students. So congratulations to Justin on winning Rotary Student of the Month.
Hello, my name is Justin Blanton, and the primary thing, as was mentioned, I would like to do something with computer science relating to computers or programming. I would love an internship at the lab, but anywhere would work. And as was mentioned, also part of the robotics team, we are hoping for a really good season this year. Any funding would also be very welcome. yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Look at that.
Yeah. All right. So I'm going to bring up Angelina. Come on up, honey. I'm going to take a picture. Throughout her time at Livermore High School, Angelina has exemplified the values of determination, creativity, passion, and a deep empathy for others, all while remaining deeply family-oriented. And that's big. That rings throughout everything that she does. Angelina's commitment to community service is inspiring. Over the past 2 years in leadership, she has worked on the Spirit and Rally Committee, helping to boost school spirit and bring the student body together through events and rallies. Her involvement in the Interact Club since her freshman year has allowed her to extend her passion for service beyond school grounds. This summer, Angelina was sponsored by the Livermore Rotary to attend the Rotary Youth Leadership Awakening Camp, a transformative experience that strengthened her leadership skills and connected her with students across the Bay Area. Angelina has expressed how this experience created a sense of family and further fueled her desire to someday become a camp counselor herself, helping to inspire the next generation of leaders. In addition to her busy schedule, Angelina works as an esthetician. I always thought I was going to trip over that word, but anyway, at her aunt's store, mastering skills like threading, applying henna, and doing hair and makeup. So I'm going to be making appointments pretty soon with you. She also works as a young girls' party venue where she hosts events and shares her joy of working with children, a passion that stems from growing up in a big family and constantly being around little ones. Academically, Angelina has taken on the challenge of 2 honor classes and 5 AP courses, excelling across her studies while maintaining a deep love for the arts. She has taken art classes all 4 years of high school, exploring her creativity through various mediums. Looking to the future, Angelina has ambitious goals that reflect her entrepreneurial spirit and desire to give back. After high school, she plans to attend a 4-year college, majoring in business or accounting, with the dream of one day building her own business in the cosmetology field. She also aspires to travel with hopes of visiting France, where she studied French for 3 years, and India, where she plans to reconnect with her cultural roots and the communities where her parents grew up. Angelina's love for animals has sparked a dream of owning a farm one day, and where she can care for animals while continuing to build her life around family. Do you see the family theme with Angelina? Okay. Most importantly, she is deeply committed to repaying her family for the many opportunities and sacrifices they've made to support her growth and success. Angelina is a shining example of what it means to lead with heart, to dream big, and to work tirelessly to achieve those dreams. So please join me in congratulating Angelina Bacchia.
Hi, everyone. My name is Angelina Bhatia. I attend Livermore High School, and I'm a senior. I'm very grateful to be chosen as Rotary Student of the Month, and I would like to thank Mrs. Muhammad for choosing me, and I would also like to take time to thank the Rotarians who sponsored me to attend Camp Ryla this past summer, because it was a life-changing experience and really made me want to reach out and become a camp counselor one day. And I hope someday in the future that I can make that impact on the young students one day. Thank you.
All right, last but not least, Kerrigan Coates. Come on up, Kerrigan. Right. Oh, we're taking a picture. I was right. All right. So Kerrigan exemplifies the core values that Rotary stands for: service, leadership, and a commitment to improving her community. Her dedication to service and integrity makes her a perfect recipient of this award. Kerrigan's contributions to her community are both extensive and impactful. Over the past few years, she has consistently sought out ways to give back, going above and beyond to make a meaningful difference. One of her most notable projects has been her involvement with local food banks, where she's volunteered countless hours organizing food drives, sorting donations, and distributing food to families in need. Her work here reflects Rotary's principle of service above self, directly addressing food insecurity in our local community. In addition to her hands-on service, Kerrigan has been a passionate advocate for mental health awareness and support. As part of Livermore High School's Wellness Center, Kerrigan has worked as a peer leader in the Culture Keeper program, providing mental health first aid and serving as a compassionate resource for students who may be struggling. Her work in this area is deeply personal, and she's made it her mission to create a safe, inclusive environment where students can find the help they need. Kerrigan's commitment to mental health aligns perfectly with Rotary's value of building goodwill and fostering connections within the communities. One of her most impactful mental health projects has been her efforts to promote mental health among student athletes. She created a training guide for coaches to help them better understand and support athletes who may be facing mental health challenges. Kerrigan's goal is to destigmatize conversations around mental health in sports and ensure that athletes receive the same level of support for their mental well-being as they do for their physical health. This initiative demonstrates her forward-thinking leadership and her dedication to improving the overall culture of our school. Beyond her mental health work, Kerrigan has been deeply involved in tutoring and mentoring programs, volunteering her time to help younger students succeed academically. Whether tutoring peers in subjects like math and science or offering guidance to incoming freshmen, Kerrigan has shown a genuine passion for helping others, ensuring that no one feels left behind. In addition, Kerrigan has been active in environmental initiatives, leading local park and green space cleanups, By encouraging her peers to participate, she has ensured that her community spaces remain beautiful and welcoming for everyone. We are very incredibly proud of Kerrigan, and I get to work with her personally with the mental health outreach, and she is a force to be reckoned with. She doesn't give up, and I love that about her. So congratulations to Kerrigan.
Hi, I'm Kerrigan. I'm a senior at Livermore High School this year. I'm very thankful to be here and thankful for Mrs. Muhammad to have me here today. So sports mental health is something that I am really passionate about. I'm applying to schools right now for college, and I want to major in psychology to pursue that. I play softball myself, so I know like the immediate struggles of mental health in the sports world. So that's something I'm really passionate about and excited to work with. Thank you.
Well, we are honored to be able to recognize such outstanding students. So a big round of applause for all of the students again. Yes, can we get a microphone back near the students so that they can introduce those members of their family who they might have been able to bring with them today? Did anybody bring a parent, a sibling?
Okay, this is my mother, Kim Blanton, and this is my dad, Mike Blanton. They've been wonderful. They've supported me with whatever I've decided to do throughout high school.
Congratulations.
And I'm very thankful for them.
These are my parents, Christina and Kevin. They've helped me a lot throughout softball and school throughout the years. I'm very grateful to have them here with me today.
Congratulations.
This is my mother, Colwinder. She's always with me wherever I go, whether it's my school events, my sporting events. She's always here to support me, so I'm glad she can be here today.
Congratulations. All right, on to our announcements here. So for those of you who haven't signed up, I have news of service October 19th. Lots of cool things going on, including they give you breakfast and lunch. So if you're feeling a little hungry and want to learn about Rotary, both can be accomplished on October 19th. All right. An opera announcement talking about the daughter of the regiment. So we're just going to spend a very quick couple of minutes. And we're going to get a glimpse into the daughter of the regiment. Jim, lead us off here.
Thank you for announcing the opera. It saved me 10 seconds. I give you Erie Mills here, who has sang as a soprano around the world. And now she devotes her time and talent to prominent opera companies like St. Louis, and Santa Fe Opera, and Livermore Valley Opera. Erie.
Thank you, Jim. And I want to thank the Rotary Club of Livermore, because I know that the foundation recently gave us a grant for our outreach program in the schools, and that's going to continue this year. So, and I want to thank, I see some people, Jack Mills and Pat McMiniman. Stand up, gentlemen. These are two of our supernumeraries in the Daughter of the Regiment. In addition to David Rounds, but I know he's been ill, so but he's getting better though. So, and I also want to thank Sonia Sheffield, because she has been our liaison between the Rotary and our supernumeraries. So I want to thank her. She's our board secretary. And thanks to the LVO board, sponsors, patrons, without whom none of this would be possible. I know there are several of you here. I see see many people. I know that many of you think of opera as a stuffy, irrelevant in today's world and not at all your cup of tea, but I would like you to consider LVO's production of The Daughter of the Regiment, La Fille du Régiment. It's a comedy by Gaetano Donizetti, sung in French with English supertitles. And even though it premiered in 1840, it has some very modern themes that are relevant to today. Number one, a strong young woman who knows her mind, is kind, courageous, and has incredible moral compass. She's a role model for every female and maybe perhaps some males in the audience. Number two, it's about extended family. I mean, for goodness sakes, how many babies are left on the battlefield and discovered then and raised by a French regiment? It's a love story. Our leading lady falls for a Tyrolean peasant, which is not the greatest thing in the world when you're raised by French soldiers. Though through some trials and tribulations, all ends happily. Words that describe the opera are funny, charming, a romp in all the good sense, and filled not only with wonderful music, hummable tunes, but filled with characters made of real flesh and blood. We have a wonderful cast, chorus, orchestra, sets, and crew assembled. Opera is the one art form that encompasses all of the art forms: singing, orchestral playing, scenery, lighting, costumes, and in the case of this wonderful comedy, even some dancing. We at LVO are very proud of the work we do, and we're very happy that Livermore and the Rotarians have embraced us for 33 years. I know Rotarians are really hard workers, so for something entertaining, for a night off or a day off, please join us on September 28, 29, October 5, and 6. I can guarantee at least once in the opera you'll laugh out loud, and a good time will be had by you and your entire family. Thank you.
Okay, that was amazing. And so if you're wondering, there's going to be a test at the end. We're going to go over the spelling and meaning of esthetician, supernumerary. Okay, so you should be taking notes. It won't be multiple choice because I know you guys are terrible at multiple choice. We're still working on that. But this is the kind of place where you can come and expand your mind as well as build good relationships. All right. We have, and Niall has led the charge on this, we have published the fall newsletter. Niall, tell us just a little bit about that. Can someone get that man a microphone? Yes, President-elect Pat can do just that. All right.
So this is what it looks like. Show of hands, how many of you have read this? Oh, it's wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Okay, if you haven't, it's beautiful, really is a beautiful document. It is loaded with interesting articles by our fellow Rotarians. It has two great stories. It has lots of pictures. It tells what our club is doing and has been doing this Rotary year. And it's only 30 pages. So read it.
And although it's 30 pages, there are lots of pictures for those of you who are not so literate. So you can figure out from context what's going on. Or those of you who have short attention spans, it is an easy read. And it's very entertaining. So I would absolutely have you wander through the entire newsletter. And the other thing is to remember, we did a lot in the first 3 months of this Rotary year, and there's lots more to come. Okay, next week, we're going to have Marianne Rosa talking about current real estate trends. Maybe we'll ask her if the Fed's cut in the Fed rate today will have any impact on real estate at all. All right. Okay. And this week, we've got Jeff Youngsma and the fire service. Sir, are you going to share with us? Who's going to introduce? Pat, are you going to introduce Jeff? Very good.
So our speaker today is one of us. Oh, there we go. Is this better?
Yeah.
Great. So our speaker today is one of our own club members, Jeff Youngsma. Jeff is a retired fire battalion chief and firefighter. Jeff joined our club in 2020, and he has been exceptionally active in many areas of our club ever since. Jeff has been a member of our club's board of directors for 2 years and currently serves as our club's vocational service chair. In addition, Jeff jointly serves our noon and morning clubs in his current term as president of the Rotarian Foundation of Livermore. I don't know how he does all this stuff, but he does it and does it very well. We are very grateful for Jeff's service as a firefighter and for this opportunity for Jeff to speak to us today about his experience in the fire service. Jeff, please come on up.
I tend to drop this a lot. It's just kind of a real singular honor to actually be asked to brag about myself or talk about myself in front of a captive crowd. So with that in mind, what I wanted to do is I really wrestled with what is it you would like to know or not know. I asked the missus, what do you think that they would like to know or not know? And they go, and they're asking you. And my response was, well, yeah. And so then I kind of thought, well, you know, the next 464 slides might get a little long. And then I realized that if a picture can paint 1,000 words and 1,000 words is a video, I'm going to go ahead and play a video with pretty much what the fire service is about, at least in the United States and somewhat locally here.
Come on, boys. Get in there. Line up, line up, line up. Come on, come on. Come on, Dean.
I'm here.
Come on.
I'm here.
6.5 minutes now. That's not bad.
Right.
We'll see you were here.
Bad.
Right. Let's go. Come on, guys.
Steve, don't be left.
Okay. The Bill Boys is Operation Snowball. Let's go. Take the truck!
Snowball.
So that's pretty much what we do, 24/7, 365. Actually, the My position on the department once I retired was the guy in the white shirt, except my nose wasn't as long, and I drove everywhere. I didn't run. So with that, I spent 33 years in the fire service, worked my way up from being a firefighter paramedic to the position of engineer apparatus operator, and then a fire officer, which is pretty much called captain, and then moved up into battalion chief. And I did a lot of roles in staff, where I was the acting fire marshal. I was the acting division chief of training and emergency medical services, and all of it very, very rewarding. And in addition to that, I also served on our incident management team, which is, I think, where we're going to take this. I think where we are going to take this presentation a little bit towards that way, on how large incidents are managed and what it takes to put something together, considering that right now we have 46 of them going on in California as we speak right now. And that's not even to talk about Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Nevada, on and on. So with that, and the other little extra braggart part is I was one of the actual first paramedics to be working in Alameda County when they approved of an Alameda County to have paramedics, and one of the first ones to start serving on a fire engine as a paramedic. So that's enough of that bragging there. Well, I kind of thought a good way to do is, you know, why do we even have a fire service? And besides the history, it was set up by insurance companies because they wanted to pay less. And in addition to your insurance company, they would have a shield that they would put on your house. And if the fire department showed up and they weren't part of your insurance company or you had a different shield, they would not put your house on fire. They would go find one that had their shield and they would wait for the fire to get there or at least keep the fire. So that... now it's turned into something, definitely a lot more professional. We'll get into that in just a bit. But our core reason why we have a modern fire service now and why it will always continue is that everything the fire service does is for the safety and the security of our chosen communities. And sometimes the community is chosen for us, and by when you're applying for fire departments, you'll take pretty much any position that you can get, and that now becomes your community. When you leave that community and you go to a different department, then that becomes your community, and it's also the community that you live in. And so we are dedicated to that at least a minimum of 120 days a year. We also believe that the service comes before self regardless, and that should all look pretty familiar to us. It's not just a line. It's everything we have. This very slide on the very left, the individual in the back, this was the station I had worked at, and the gentleman in the back not wearing a uniform, he had suffered a heart attack, was totally unconscious, unresponsive. His heart had stopped, and we brought him back, and he walked out of the hospital 2 weeks later. And that's through the actions of these two crews, along with myself. So they wanted to show an appreciation by bringing us a pineapple upside down cake. And so we decided we would go ahead and serve them dinner. Now, how does the fire service do providing our service? Well, we provide professional services and training. We always do a community analysis. We have public outreach. We establish a reasonable budget. Lord knows Marcus had to see more of those than he cares to count. We provide, you know, the best equipment that we can afford, and we develop policies and procedures to meet that community analysis and our public outreach. So what does the fire service do, or what can you expect? Well, we do emergency medical aids. It's about 68% of every response that we go on, hence why we start putting paramedics on every engine company, and I'll get in that in a bit, and every truck company. We obviously do fire suppression, fire prevention, fire investigation, hazardous materials mitigation, public relations, fire administration, community investment, and professional training and certifications. And so it really proves that most of us in the fire service are educated well beyond our intelligence. And with that, it does allow us to provide a variety of services as the positions have changed from just suppressing fires for insurance companies to doing all of these here. And who knows what it's going to grow into after that. So who responds in Livermore? So this is our community. Now, I work for the city of Fremont. So, you know, I service the citizens of Fremont, but I do live here in Livermore. And so a lot of what we did in Fremont is akin to what is done in Livermore. Some things we were a model, some things they were a model. And that's really pretty cool. So right now, the Livermore Pleasanton Fire Department responds to everything within those city limits. And the Livermore Pleasanton Fire Department is a joint powers agreement. And they're one of the few in the states that do that, which means they share the responsibility, the leadership, the administration, the budgets together. They're not a contract. It's not Livermore is in charge and Pleasanton tags along, or Pleasanton's in charge and Livermore tags along. They share the responsibility and the budget equally. And if you have any questions about that, ask Mark. Now, the Alameda County Fire Department responds in the unincorporated areas, and they're also contracted with the lab. Now, I know for those of you that worked at the lab for quite some time, you used to have your very own fire department under the UC Berkeley system. Well, that no longer happened. They decided to contract with the Alameda County Fire Department. Numerous other organizations, or I should say other cities also contract with the Alameda County Fire Department, and that's like the city of San Leandro, Union City, Newark, Dublin. Emeryville and Berkeley Lab also has that. So, and what they have with Livermore Pleasanton is they have what they call border drops, which means whichever is the closest fire apparatus to whatever the incident is, that's who's going to go, whether it's within city limits or not in city limits. And then there's also the California Department of Forestry, or I should say California Department of Fire and Forestry. They're called CAL FIRE, otherwise known as CDF. You'll see Alameda County Department is ACF and LPF, and those are actually our max identification. All it really means is that when we go on these big giant campaign fires, we can look at the side of something, and if it says LPF, we know that that's Livermore Pleasanton. And then we always have specific numbers too, and I'll get into that in a bit. What you can expect out of these departments, and as well as Fremont itself, is we respond and work in local, regional, state, and federal mutual aid. And we're required willingly to participate in those. And then we become, if it's a regional thing, we become property of whoever regionally is in charge. If it's the state, then we become property of them. And if it's federal, then we become property of them. We also, in all of these, we also participate in the incident management teams, particularly the one here for the East Bay is the East Bay Incident Management Team Type 2, which I was the plan section chief of, and then also in FEMA, California Task Force 4, and that's like the ones who went to the World Trade Center. They're the ones who were on standby for the big fires in Maui, were the ones that went down to Los Angeles when Los Angeles has something, and that then we're working under the federal government. And so if they say hop on one foot, we're supposed to hop on one foot. And if you are in Livermore and you see a Fremont fire engine at the incident, you know this thing must be pretty large. So with that, and again, you know, we all work under the California Office of Emergency Services and the FEMA, and with FEMA. So that covers that. Clear as mud, and we'll go on. The incident command system. Now, this is more of when I started operating as a battalion chief, something that we really started. It was our responsibility to make sure that we were tracking resources. And we found that this is about the most efficient way to do that. So what it is it's a method of having a span of control. And we like to call it a 5-to-1 ratio. There are times to where it can be 7-to-1. Sometimes you can only be 3-to-1. depending on the complexity of it, but it's something that can expand and reduce as needed. And I heard somebody's phone. What this does is it helps reduce duplication of work and creates common objectives. It is nationwide. However, it did start in California back in the 1970s when all the big wildfires happened. Currently, it's used by, you know, the fire services, it's used by FEMA, FDA, Department of Homeland Security, Department of Energy, the United States Coast Guard, just recently, the United States Air Force. I know because I got to fly out to Utah to train them. That was 4 wonderful days of being awake all night. And then it is also used by the California National Guard, primarily their Seaburn 91st Squad, which I have worked intimately with as also. These are all qualified and certified positions. That's part of adding to the professionalism. So it's not that you can just step in and say, I'm now the guy in charge. There's a lot that you have to go through to be that. And it can expand and contract as the incident requires. This particular picture was the planning meeting that we had for the Santa Rosa fire when it started burning into Santa Rosa itself. We had to move the emergency operations center to someplace. And since Santa Rosa was burning, we had to put it someplace where it wasn't. And we're going to keep that story in mind for a couple of other things. This is what the incident command system looks like. And the reason I kind of bring this up is it's not that different from any other management thing. We just gave it some fancy titles and to get everything in there. Everything in red, those are the people that have to do the work. They're the ones going out in the field doing the work. The people in blue, they're the ones that are telling what work needs to be done, where it needs to be done, at what time it needs to be done, and who you need to report to. And we do that by creating what we call an incident action plan. It's a very involved document. And then we keep track of all the documents. Logistics, nothing moves without logistics. They're the ones that make sure that the people in red have everything they need to be able to do the work. They have the hose, they have the shovels, they have the helicopters, they have food, they have a place to sleep, they have somebody that can fix vehicles. And the green, somebody's got to pay for all of this. And somebody's got to find the funding for all of this. And somebody's got to keep track of the payroll. Somebody's got to keep track of the damage we cause and compensate for that. And some of it is just, okay, how do we get somebody else to help pay for this? Because our reserves only cover so much. And then everybody in white, that's who is in charge. And then underneath that are their staffs that they only answer to the incident commander and the incident commander alone. They do not answer to the operations section chief, plan section chief, logistics section chief, or the finance. And even here in the city of Livermore, we have an emergency operations center, which can be set up, and everybody ends up taking these positions somewhere in the city government. It's not just dumped on the fire service, it's not just dumped on the police, it's not just jumped on Mark's desk and said, okay, you're going to be here in charge. Mark is going to have people in these positions and somebody advising Mark on how the incident command system works, especially as federal and state entities start arriving with that. So that's kind of the importance of that. And just about every city has something like this, has some type of plan that operates with this. And within the city of Fremont, we're very egotistical. And yet there I was, the plan section chief, telling the assistant city manager how to do their job. He was not happy. Okay, so let's kind of do, I asked Pat, so thank you, Pat, for this suggestion. Where this all kind of came into play is we'll take a look at a case study of the SCU fire in 2020. Now, this was the fire, so it started August 16th, was when it was first reported at 9:25 a.m. It was contained in October 1st of 2020, so that was active for 46 days, and it was finally completed with the project closed out in October 21st, 2022. So that is when every bill was paid. That's when restoration of all those lands were taken into account and said, okay, everything is back. It's as fixed as we can get. So these are long incidents. And while this all goes on, there is an incident management team in different factions taking care of all this, primarily the finance. This particular incident, the SCU incident, which also had one going on in Santa Cruz that was burning this general way, and another one up in Lake County that was in Lake County, Napa, which was kind of burning down. And so remember, we just had nothing, but you got up in the morning and all you saw was orange glow all day long, and your filters clogged up within 3-4 days. And you go to Lowe's or Home Depot and they don't have any. And then you go on Amazon and realize they don't have any. This is why. Okay, so, and what was interesting about this one is it affected 6 different counties: Santa Clara, Alameda, Contra Costa, San Joaquin, Merced, and Stanislaus County. That's a lot of counties. So you can see how having an incident management team and having to work all that coordination comes in together. So that is something your fire service does that you didn't realize was a part of it. That is roughly just how big the SEU fire was. And that smaller picture that you can kind of see in there, that just shows you how windy it was a few days after the start, to where aircraft could not fly. And we rely very heavily on aircraft. They weren't able to fly because the winds were just too strong, which means that fire's just going to keep going the way it's going to go. And we can't fly in front of it to stop it. We can't fly to the side of it to stop it. So everything we have to do is handwork or bulldozers. Okay, so on the fire line, this is what is needed to actually start putting that fire out. And that 46 days of active, this is what took place all 46 days for in 24 hour spurts. We had aircraft flying from 9 o'clock in the morning till sunset. Aircraft does not fly at night. We had hand crews. Now, all hand crews just work a 12-hour rotation because of the work that they do. And with that, then a night crew will come in and pick up where they left off. They'll go back in. They'll take some sleep, eat some food, and then they'll be out there again in the morning. We have heavy equipment, primarily bulldozers, harvesters, haulers. We have engine companies, type 1s, type 3s, and type 6s. And to really, type 1, that's the one you always see at the grocery store that shows up at your house. A type 3 is the four-wheel drive, you know, kind of those big four-wheel drive ones. And the type 6s are the smaller ones that look like they're a pickup truck with the little hose on it. They're also known as strike teams and task force. And all that really means is that either they're like equipment or they have like capabilities, they have common communication, and they have somebody who's actually in charge of them all. We have to have safety officers, which work totally independent of everybody else. We have field observers, so we can find out in the plans how big this thing is getting, where it needs to go next, where the priorities are going to be, so we can report that to the incident commander. We have to have division supervisors, because we break this thing up in that 5-to-1. And then if it gets big enough, then we needed branch supervisors. So all that means is that's that incident command system could grow, get small, grow, and we could keep building on it to take care of the emergency. So what was needed? So when everything was going through for all the requests, we needed a lot of 4x4 type engines, mutual aid. We needed water tenders. So, you know, those nice big water trucks. We didn't care whether it carried 1,000 gallons or 5,000 gallons. We needed incident management teams. And the reason that I say teams is not only that, but it's, you can't have the same people sitting there for 46 days. We would rotate those out, you know, every 2 weeks. So they would have a chance, or every 3 weeks. My longest deployment was a month one time, but that was a federal response. Bulldozers, snot load of bulldozers. Aircraft, planes, and helicopters. And as a matter of fact, on Greenville Road was a helicopter standby point, which was pretty cool. Hand crews, usually coming from California Department of Forestry, the California Department of Corrections, the United States Forest Service, and Bureau of Land Management. And if you're getting Bureau of Land Management, it just shows you how tapped the system really, really is for them to come out and help with the fires. We also need security. We needed CHP. We had to have the sheriffs out. We needed the prison system to watch over the prisoners, and that's the Department of Corrections. And then, of course, just the local law enforcement to maintain the local laws of what goes on there. And then we also had to get the Office of Emergency Services and FEMA involved, because not only do they have the ability for resources and can expedite that, they also have funding methods to pay for all of this. So, base camp. When I talk about base camp and why that's important is, on these types of incidents, it's not that the fire engine just works its 24-hour, the crew just works its 24-hour day, and then they drive back to their home unit, wherever that is. They need to stay and be ready to be available. And so usually we find a fairgrounds or a military base or sometimes a school during summers that isn't being used. And we'll set up a base camp there. And that's where the incident management team will go. We're going to need fuel for all these vehicles. We're going to need to have equipment and a storage house for, I mean, all of those different kind of things. Goggles, gloves, additional hose, forms, everything goes with the form. Sometimes you need a form for ordering more forms. We need to feed these people. We need to have areas to sleep. We need to be able to have hygiene. And we need to also have a secure area for the inmates. So not only is that to protect the inmates, it's also to protect everybody who's not an inmate. And we'll work hand in hand with them fairly closely, but it always has to be at a bit of a distance. Our work area is with power for 24/7. So if you're working on the night shift, using your computer, whatever, you need to have someplace with power. Parking for everybody, mechanics to fix all the stuff that breaks. And trust me, stuff breaks. Communications. As a matter of fact, that's what that special van is, and it has all the dispatchers that are on there. A medical station for anybody who gets injured while either at base camp or on the fire line. We were just having a discussion earlier about poison oak. Mentioned the word. I get it. For those from the East Coast, poison ivy, poison sumac, it's the same thing. And trust me, nothing's worse than pouring a bunch of Benadryl, falling asleep on the fire line because you have so much Benadryl in you and nothing to take care of the poison oak. GIS, weather, and ITS support, designated airports. Thank goodness we had the Livermore Airport that we were able to move aircraft to so they could land there, fuel up, get their mud, which is that orange stuff, we affectionately call it mud, and then take back off. And then in the evening, when they were done flying, they would go back to their home base for all of their repairs. So we were lucky with that. Designated landing zones for the helicopters. Like I said, there's one was set up on Greenville Road. And this list just goes on. And the reason that I mentioned and put some emphasis on the base camp is for the Tubbs Fire Complex, which I believe we at this Rotary Club donated money to, I believe in 2017, if I recall. It's before, obviously, I came on. And anyways, where I wanted to kind of wrap up, or not wrap up, but at least just put some emphasis on is that with the incident management teams, with the fire service, not everything we do is fire related. So even though this Tubbs fire, and we can see just how large that was, and how it crept down into Coffee Park and Santa Rosa and burned all those homes there in the Rincon Valley. But there is also a place in Sonoma County that is known as the Sonoma County Development Center. And that's basically individuals who are, lack of a better term, wards of the state. They're not movable. They're mentally challenged. They have many physical disabilities. Their facility was going to be overrun. I know I have a photo of that. And so they needed to be evacuated. The problem is their first initial evacuation center was also under threat of fire. So they had to evacuate that. So their secondary place was actually going to be at the Bastonia Vineyards, and that was overrun. So they had to travel from Sonoma all the way to the Dixon May Fairgrounds in the city of Dixon, because what they wanted was not something that would be affected by fire and have to transport these people again. Now, with all these incident management teams already tied up at fires, they reached out to our team, which is a smaller team, to basically set up a base camp for them and get them evacuated. So I responded on the evacuation part of it initially as both a safety officer and the planned sections officer. This is the fire as it was coming into that picture, as it was coming into Eldridge, which had to be evacuated. So we had to evacuate 226 low function or bedridden individuals, 76 staff. They have very, very specific needs. And for those that have had special needs individuals that you know, each one of these had special needs. And so gathering all that together. We were already on their third evacuation site, which was at the Dixon May Fairgrounds. They went there because it was a state-owned fairgrounds, it being a state facility. And you've been to fairgrounds, that is not the most hygienic, stabilizing setup, a type of hospital that you would need with, God, what was it, the number? It was 186 bedridden individuals. So each one had to have a special hospital bed specific for them set up. Not usually in my realm of expertise on how to make that happen. We reported directly to the Health and Human Services Undersecretary, worked with him directly, and he had direct contact with Gavin. And as I said before, you know, there was zero infrastructure. All we had was two large barns and a couple of small offices, and that was it. That was it. So these large barns became the hospital, and the small offices became areas where the 76 staff could house themselves while they were there. So our East Bay incident management team, we were type three at that time. OES was totally out of type one and type two teams. So we were over to see the evacuation at Dixon. We had to develop and inform the governor, the governor's office, OES, and the Health and Human Services via incident action plans. And that's a 24-hour plan. So we always had to be available 24 hours. That's pretty much the team, that photo that you see there, and we'll forget about that ding-dong there in the very front. But the rest of us there were all working, and that was pretty much just our team. And we were a 24/7 team. We had to provide the special, you know, the special needs infrastructure for the base camp. And we had already talked about base camp, everything that they need to have in there. So just imagine having to order that and also having it special needs and still being able to take care of all that. We needed to provide housing for the staff affected. We had to liaison with local agencies, so the police department, CHP, and especially when repopulation, the Dixon Fire Department, which is two stations. You know, a population, I think, in Dixon is maybe 40,000, and we just dropped, you know, almost a quarter of people that all need special needs that can't help themselves, and we just dumped them in there without any pre-warning. So that took some work, and we had to deal with Caltrans as well. Then we had to start preparing, as the fire had moved on, start preparing the Sonoma Development Center for reoccupation, because we were losing about 5 to 10 clients. They didn't like calling them patients, called them clients. We were losing, you know, 5 to 10 per night just because of the facility, and it had nothing to do with the care, had nothing to do with that. It was just strictly out of, we could not get all of what they needed at a level that they needed at the time. And so that's, so suddenly we became the top priority in the governor's office. And then we had to repopulate the Sonoma Development Center. And that in itself was cocktail worthy for sure. So these were the challenges, and I already kind of covered it. These are the challenges that we faced. You know, fairground is not set up for this. It's set up for animals. It's set up for fried food that you would never fry at home. It's set up for carnival games. You know, this is not in our general playbook. We had unique and client requirements. This isn't, we can just put them up in hotels. This is, they needed something special. We were oversaw by the government's office, which means every T crossed and every I dotted, like it or not, poor city of Dixon just wasn't prepared. All of a sudden they wake up one morning, you know, with this mess on their hands. Funding sources, nobody knew who was going to be paying for this right off the bat. And so some of us for the first 48 hours were using our own personal credit cards, or state given credit cards, just to get vendors in with additional beds, to get toiletry services, you know, those outhouses, to get tents like this set up so we could actually occupy it. We had to be a little worried about mission creep. And that was, hey, since you're here, do you think you could? Hey, since you're here, do you think you could? And we needed to worry about that. We had multiple agencies to do with. And, you know, everything we did was kind of below the radar. You know, meaning that the Tubbs fire was getting a ton of attention, but not much attention was giving to the development center and their needs. So That is with that. So that will conclude my presentation. There's just a couple of things I wanted to point out. There are some really cool apps that you can get. There's Pulse Point, which will, if you want to know what your local fire service is doing, that's a way of pulling that up. And in addition, it will also notify you that if you are in an area or near somebody and somebody is having a heart attack, an emergency, something that involves CPR, it'll show you where the AEDs are and it will notify you. I've been in a movie theater when suddenly this thing has gone off and realized, oh, in the theater next door, somebody was having a medical issue. There's Broadcastify, so that's basically a scanner that you can get on your phone. And then the CAL FIRE website, they have the fire planner if you need to know what you need to evacuate. And they have many other things, how to put defense on your homes. And with that, so I can open it up. I know it was a little bit long, but if there's any questions or comments, you can catch me after all of this is over. And if you have any stories, save them for drinking time. And with that, thank you very much. It's been an honor.
All right. Thank you, Jeff. Now you have a hard decision to make. Olive oil, white wine, or red wine? Red wine. Here we go, sir. Thank you very much. All right. All right. How about a big round of applause? If you have questions, I bet Jeff will stick around. And boy, the SCU fire was an interesting one for us. We're going to do tickets in just a quick second as it was approaching the city of Livermore from the south. If you happen to live in the Wetmore area or south of Alden Lane, we were making plans for your evacuation. So there's nothing more sobering to figure out that you may have to move 10,000 people out of the path of a fire. And thank goodness it stayed far enough away from us, so all of you got to sleep in your own bed that night. All right, with that, we've got a